chair for this meeting prior to commencement of the meeting. So Ria will explain the card, the process that we need to kind of follow really to kind of establish a chair for the meeting. So I hand it over to Ria.
So as you're all aware that Councillor Ayres, who presided over this committee, is now retired as a councillor. He's obviously retired from the authority. The AGM is the 14th of June, and as this meeting performance and scrutiny is the last one of the municipal year, the AGM can deal with this committee going forward on the 14th. But obviously for today's meeting to go ahead, I'd like to invite members to move to nominate a visiting member to chair the meeting today.
Thank you, colleagues. John, I was here, really. Has everybody got the agenda?
Yes.
I don't think I've got one here. So thank you for that. This will be resolved at the AGM. Are there any apologies for this meeting? Councillor Stapleton. Okay. And Chief Fire Officer. Declarations of interest, matters of urgency, don't think we're changing the agenda, and I don't see any pink papers, so nothing there. This meeting is being filmed. If anybody has any objection to being filmed, usual thing, please say now or be filmed. No problems. Okay, moving into the agenda itself. Minutes. Minutes are circulated here. Are there any factual alterations, any changes? Otherwise, can those minutes be agreed? Those are agreed. Thank you very much. I'll sign those in a moment.
Make more comments on in relation to the minutes that have just been agreed. Just in relation to the youth engagement update, a specific reference made to where which was taking place in Moseley. I'm pleased to announce to councillors we are now in the process of implementing a Prince's Trust team which will operate out of Kirby Fire Station. That's on the basis of some of the comments that were made by members previously, but we will update and provide a briefing in a bit more detail as and when that arises, but just thought it would be useful to bring to people's attention given the fact that it was raised in the minutes and after the performance and speaking meeting last time. Thanks,
Chair. Okay, thank you. Any comments or observations on that? Okay. So next is item 3, service delivery plan, end of year report 15-16.
Thanks, Chair. As is normal process, Jackie Sutton will take us through the service delivery plan update as part and parcel of the presentation which will accompany the report, and then we'll take questions at the conclusion of that. So I'll hand it over to Jackie and she can take you through it.
Good afternoon, I'm Jackie Sutton and I'm the Integrated Risk Management Plan Officer. Today we're going to look at the whole 15-16 reporting on the fourth quarter as we do our reporting community at the end of the year. Reporting on the page. Each function has its own functional delivery plan, and there are 38 service delivery plan functional plan action points for 2015-16. 13 are complete. Amongst them are the local firefighter pension board, which is now set up. The firefighter pension scheme is now in place. The members' room, which you probably all enjoy, is set up. The new ICT infrastructure contract has been signed, and the asset management plan has been approved by yourselves. 25 have been subsumed into functional plan action points for 16-17. It means that they were in progress, they've progressed well, and they're now probably on to the next stage. Things like the capability procedure and revised absence policy. introduced and we're continuing to embed them. Development plans for the TDA, the training school, and the branding and new website work will continue. Of the key performance indicators, 14 have met their target, 10 are within 10% of target, only 2 failed to reach their target this year, and 1 is reported annually but unable to get this information at present. This is LPI 10B, which is a percentage of young people on Prince's Trust courses moving into education, going into training. They've not been able to get these figures for us, but we will report them as soon as we have them. Areas where KPI performance is on or above target. The number of deliberate ANSP fires, we've had 4,035 this year. That's 118 less than the same time last year. Accidental dwelling fires, 93.4% of accidental dwelling fires are confined to home of origin. The target is 92. We attend all life risk incidents within 10 minutes on 95.9% of occasions. The target is 90. Sickness absence. We can report that at the end of the year, 6.16 shifts were lost to all staff against 8.8 shifts last year. Uniform staff, 6.33 shifts were lost against 9.29 last year. Non-uniformed, 5.7 shifts lost against 7.81 last year. Total operational staff injuries was on target at 53. And because routine activity duties, accidents increased, but they were balanced out by the other type of injuries that we have, which is risk critical training and incidents. So in actual fact, that's how we hit the target. We go back to the number of working days lost to sickness absence, as you can see the figures there. Long-term sick is down by over 50%. Short-term sick, however, is increasing. Capability has started to have an impact, and robust management has brought down long-term sick. Some people have left us, and some people have come back to work, and we're managing our short-term sickness more proactively now. KPIs within 10% of the target. Total number of fires have gone up this year. We've got 7,171 compared to 6,871 last year. Primary fires have also gone up. We had 2,618 compared to 2,503 last year. Accidental dwelling fires, we're only 4 over target. We had 1,086 against a target of 1,082. There was a spike in March, which probably accounts for this. There were 180 incidents against a target of 85, and 74 of them kitchen fires, interestingly. Deliberate vehicle fires. There were 516 deliberate vehicle fires against a target of 503. All districts were amber this year, which meant they were in 10% of the target, apart from St Helens, who achieved their target. The Wirral had the most stations that exceeded their target, and it was generally thought to be down to criminality with cars, scooters, motorbikes being set on fire. KPIs were targets were not met. Sadly, we've had 16 fatal fires, accidental dwelling fires this year. That was actually 16 deaths in 13 fires. It's very unusual we've had 3 double fatalities this year. And another KPI that didn't meet its target was operational staff injuries conducting other routine duties, that's stuff on station things. There were 28 injuries reported, which is 6 more than last year. I'll go on to give a little bit more detail. Obviously, when we looked into the number of fatalities that happened in the accidental dwelling fire this year, we realised that there were 3 which were double fatalities. So we looked back to see if there had been any other years where that's happened, and it's only happened twice. In 2002-03, we had 1 double fatality, and in 2013-14, the same. So it's very unusual this year that we've had 3 double fatalities. On the causes of the fires, we've looked into this. 8 of the fires, which accounted for 9 casualties, were caused by smokeless material. Of the fatal fires we've had, 9 were over 65 years of age. Of them, 3 were over 70 and 4 were over 80. 7 lived alone, and obviously there were 3 double fatalities. Only one property did not have smoke alarm fitted. Four were known to have actuated at the fire. Nine we don't know if they actuated, and two had no batteries in them. Source of the fires, the room where it started, three were in the kitchen, five were in the lounge, four in the bedroom, and one in the hallway. Operational staff injuries conducting routine duties. Our OSHA's recording system gives the crews a number of options when they record injuries. During routine duties, the majority of the slip, trip, fall on the same level, that's all one category, and handling, lifting or carrying. The majority were caused by lifting and carrying. Some were slips and falls, and one, I think, was struck by a moving flying object. None of them resulted in any serious injuries at all. Most were sprains, strains or bruising. When we met with our lead member last week, we were discussing kitchen fires, and I can report that in 15-16 we had 207 kitchen fires in RSL properties. In 14-15 we had 183. We think this part of this is due to the way that crews record kitchen fires. There's a lot of question and arguments about whether there was smoke, whether it was out of control, which is the main definition, was the fire out of control that makes it a kitchen fire. It's thought that the reporting in IRS could be skewing these figures slightly, and our protection team are doing some in-depth work on each of these incidents to have a look and see if they've been recorded correctly. KPIs reported annually. One of our KPIs is to increase the diversity of our workforce and volunteers. This year we have actually had recruitment for the first time. Years. So we had 16 firefighters recruited, 13 were male, 3 female, 14 white, 1 BME, and 1 prefer not to say. Recruitment, the apprentices that we took on, there were 12 apprentices, 7 male, 5 female, 11 white, and 1 BME. And this is now going to become our benchmark for future recruitment. So we will benchmark against this now for the future.
I've just wondered about the short-term illnesses. Is there anything that's, you know, coming out of that? Do you think it's stress or what is the main? You've no idea what.
I'll respond to that. Because I'm probably a little closer than Jackie. Yes, stress is, you know, mental health, anxiety, and a whole change of definition, which is described by doctors, but it is playing a significantly large part of that short-term absence, and that can be down to just the kind of the current climate of the circumstances for individuals. But that is not just Merseyside Fire Rescue Service, that is very similar in regard to any form of work now, really, whether in the public sector or indeed beyond that. You're seeing increases in mental health and debilitating illness such as that. But we still have to count the other issues around short-term absence associated with flu, and stomach upset and so on and so forth. And lesser now than it's probably been in the past, but still, you know, muscular injury as well. So, you know, back injuries or, you know, because of the physical nature of the role of firefighters, which results in short-term absence as well. But we are seeing, you know, an increase in mental illness and mental health, anxiety and stress.
And we have provision to address that, don't we?
Absolutely. And one of the returns said there's a number of occasions to members, and we'll look at the kind of reductions in the long term sickness absence and the fact that we've made some significant inroads into sickness absence over the period due to the implementation of some policies and procedures. But it's not just the capability policies and procedures that we've introduced, it is also, in my view, there's evidence to support what we're saying now. The kind of occupational health support that we provide is absolutely first class, right? And I would hold it up against any authority in the UK Fire Rescue Service and beyond that, you know, around particularly folks around mental wellbeing. And we stopped utilising the word like stress and anxiety, and we're talking about wellness of individuals who work in this service. And we've been recognised multiple times more recently, and we've certainly done a lot of fire rescue services. We're showing a significant amount of interest in the way which we do business here, and in protecting our context and the exposure that they have to some horrific scenes, but also, you know, for our non-uniformed staff who are equally stressed at times for different causal reasons, and we have a really wraparound supportive service which they can access at any point in time, and I think that's, you know, testimony to the decisions that the authorities made over that period as well. I think it is well recognised by our staff as well.
Thanks,
thank you. Leslie.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, my question was on short-term stuff as well, but just an observation as well on the number of long-term sick, which has come down. Jackie said it had gone down by 50%, which clearly is really good news. Because from what I can recall, that obviously creates a problem with staffing arrangements and the number of people that can go out on shifts. I mean, has there been any sort of, has it fed through into that we now have more people available, or have they been long-term sick and perhaps left the service? I don't know. Just a bit of an explanation on that one, really. And sorry, I should have said, Chair, right at the beginning, I've just noticed within the glossary of terms and within the detail of the report, there's mention of fire support network, where I'm a trustee. But,
clearly
interested. Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. In response to that, it's a combination of, so, you know, and certainly, you know check the shard as robust management. It's not really that robust, it's probably more akin to case management, so we're working through those individuals who have been off for a longer period of time and looking at what support arrangements we can put in place to get them back to work, because that is ultimately the driver for us. And that's about kind of getting, you know, ensuring people get to surgery, and I've certainly taken it as expedient as possible. Significant amount of work around mental well-being, so, you know, affording cognitive behaviour therapies and the likes to assist them get back to work. We have, as you know, a fitness advisor who works with individuals who, for whatever reason, have put on some excessive weight, and we give them fitness regimes and fitness plans to, you know, reduce the amount of time that they're on fire plans and, you know, when they clearly are employed to be a firefighter or a watch manager. And so that has resulted in a fairly significant number of individuals returning back to operational duties. And there is a small number, and it is genuinely only a small number of individuals which probably lift the kind of concern in our capability of brought them back to work when arguably, you know, they may well have not come back to work as expediently as possible. And I think we are in low numbers of two or three where they've been down to medical discharge. So, you know, we would put them through an independent medical process. And the doctor would say then that actually, you know what, they're no longer medically fit to undertake the role, and that would be something that we would enact, and clearly that again has been an aspect of that reduction in long-term sickness absence. So it's a collective combination of all of those, which is, as Jackie said, has resulted in quite a significant reduction in sickness. What you'll find is there's a report going to come back to the authority on sickness and looking at HR policies and procedures, which was, if members will recall, it was a request of when we implemented them in the first instance, to see what impact they would have over the period and see how they would be received by the organisation more broadly. And I've got to say, it's been, you know, received positively, because they're seen, as Councillor Sullivan says, as a very supportive way to bring people back into work, which is what we are all seeking to achieve. So, you know, to answer Councillor Rennie's, you know, question, it is a combination of supportive measures, you know, and also capability and medical discharge, which has resulted in that really significant reduction in long-term sickness absence.
Thanks, Chair. One, like meetings last week, I went to the Health and Safety Committee, and I suppose Dave Mottams have been reported possibly in the near future regarding the occupational health. I think members see this report or what this occupational health service does in the sort of policy. It's mind-blowing. I'm not just saying that because I was involved in that, but the partnership between the management and the unions is absolutely first class, and the commitment from the authority to support. I mean, my guess is the staff there, you don't know how lucky you are, because that's how good that occupational is within the organisation. And I've asked, can we come back with a further report to the level where the lunch will probably let you see what goes in and how the help that is given to staff and support five other authorities at Merseyside could learn a lot from this, and that's not underestimating what I'm saying. It's absolutely first class, and they treat their staff as not as a commodity but as an asset, and that is absolutely fantastic. And hopefully, when you see it, you will really endorse what I'm just saying, because it's absolutely first class. And hopefully, they will bring this back to you in the near future, and it will highlight how good this authority is in supporting their staff through illness and fitness and whatever in general.
Thank you. It is good to see the statistics going in the right direction. We have an unusual workforce, a little bit older, and also has to do quite physical things. And so we have we always have had as an authority a responsibility and duty to look after our greatest asset. And good to see those statistics come back. Again, our policy to move towards self-rostering, giving people control over their times. We're working on all of this. As we go around the fire stations, okay, you get a different feel from different firefighters, but the general picture is things getting better. Thank you. Is there any more on this particular? Yes.
Yeah. Could you say, Jeff, some of the figures there are outstanding. You know, the room of origin. You know, the figures for that are really good. Just shows, you know, even though with all the cuts, still meeting very high standards.
It's a funny thing. This is something we discussed earlier. We can put in smoke detectors, we can have things that don't burn, but actually, this is something that came some years ago, the Building Research Institute, shutting the doors in your house makes such a big impact on the survivability of a fire. And getting little messages like that out is, again, what we're about. Anything else on that item there? Thank you very much for the presentation, very much appreciated. And I think we will very much look forward to a presentation on the health and safety policy. We've had one before, but it's good time to refresh on that. Okay, so that's item three. Four, Equality and Diversity Action Plan.
Thanks, Chair. We're joined by Wendy Kenyon, who's the Equality and Diversity Manager, who's gone to my left-hand side, and certainly Wendy can pick up any specific questions if members have got them. The purpose of this report is to bring back an update on the third and fourth quarter, which again ties in with the end of year update in regard to the Equality and Diversity Action Plan, which members will recall was our vehicle for delivering equality excellence over the period and was introduced in 2013. I won't take members necessarily through the kind of contents of the report, but what I will do is just highlight some of the areas which I think think we should be incredibly proud of, and Wendy's tried to do that within the whole document. But I'll just bring your attention to the action plan and the progress from paragraph 8 onwards, which talks about knowing your communities, and then moves on to leadership, partnership and organisation, and then improving your communities, and so on and so forth. The language that is used there is aligned to the equalities framework, and so it reflects the kind of the work that we need to do, and we need to be able to evidence as we move forward and demonstrate that. But we have worked around road safety presentations with particularly 15 to 19 year olds over the period, which again reflects that equalities objective to reduce those young persons who are involved in road traffic collisions. But we've also extended that to look at senior users, so older people who are actually vulnerable in relation to being pedestrians, not necessarily drivers, under certain sets of circumstances, to ensure that we are delivering some intervention at that level as well. Some of our work is extended into funding arrangements which have secured smoke alarm mix for the hard of hearing, and we've developed our vulnerable persons team, which is specifically focused on the causal factors, and we've talked about age being one of them, but you'll see case studies within the report talks about how we've utilised Polish speaking advocates to address some of the anti-social behaviour related issues and so on and so forth. So that's about knowing the makeup of our communities and be able to discharge our responsibilities accordingly and understand what issues are affecting our communities on a daily basis. Also, our focus has been particularly around older people. You'll see details of the number of home fire safety checks we've completed on older persons today, and more broadly. Our whole home safety focus now is around people who are over 65 for obvious reasons around their particular vulnerability. not only are we utilising what is Exeter data, which allows us to kind of focus particularly on that age group for Merseyside, I think it's incumbent for me to kind of mention of it. Deb and her team, particularly Julie Yarn and Jean Coons, have been championing that work nationally. So, some of their support has allowed us to support other fire and rescue services access information to target their resources better. In regards to a little bit around leadership and partnership and organisational commitments, and some of these things may just pass members by, really, if not brought to your attention. But things like introducing breastfeeding guidance, things like having a menopausal policy and guidance are very, very important to our female firefighters and shouldn't be overlooked. And again, we have shared some of those procedures and policies more broadly with the fire sector because they haven't necessarily picked up on some of those things. And that is at the behest of the Female Firefighters Forum, which has been developed over the period as well. Picking up again around the comments made by Councillor Sullivan around mental ill health, we also have the Mind Blue Light Pledge, which we've signed on behalf of the authority. Councillor Hamratty, as the chair, equally signed the pledge, committing ourselves to working around the mental health and wellbeing, internally but also externally. And we are working with Bridle Mind, because we've accessed in the region of £100,000 to support those blue light services more broadly, based on the quality of the interventions we do in Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service. But we will work with the ambulance and the police to extend that more broadly and share some of our learning. We've hosted over the period the first Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority International Women's Day, and we have a number of speakers from the UK Fire and Rescue Service who are in different roles within the service and recognise the benefits that that could have for the career with ourselves, but also the fire and rescue service more broadly. And we've had, and I would say this one man, but facilitated World Cafe events where we had members of the authority meet with members of our staff, and that went down really, really well with our staff, feeling as though we've got members who were interested in their role, irrespective of whether that was an operational or whether it's more specifically down to an administrative role or a supporting role. And I think our staff and hopefully members got a significant amount of that. Then involved in our communities, and again, I won't reiterate the point, but we've got examples there around firefighters, watch managers, crew managers working in our communities for the best possible outcomes. And then our examples of our arson reduction advocate working with our Polish speaking advocates to address the issues that affect our communities more broadly. We've also, and certainly lead members were in attendance, we've also looked at the business community, so not just the people living in their own homes. And we nationally now leading on this piece of work is how we engage with the diverse business community, recognising that actually we may be unintentionally disproportionately affecting certain groups because of lack of information or lack of clarity around how we can trace some of those messages. And we are in the process on behalf of the Chief Fires Association of developing a toolkit that can be applied nationally in regard to that business engagement. We also, again, highlight all the positives, but certainly it's incumbent on me, really. We've introduced Puffle, and Puffle is a staff engagement tool, really, but it's very much for staff to utilise and create groups and come together as running clubs and so on and so forth. But we're predetermined that we would like a couple of groups to be established with some kind of lead people within that. One is around mental health and well-being and support, and that's a safe place where people can have a discussion, and it might be about them, or it might be about their family or their partner or whatever else, but they can have it with people like-minded individuals who have either had or experienced those difficulties or are able to support someone. But it's a safe place for them to open up that discussion, and we thought that was very important. And we have just, and members will be aware, we launched Fire Proud, which is our work with the LGBT network, created an LGBT network in Merseyside Fire Rescue, which again we should be incredibly proud of. And we've introduced Fire Proud, where we will seek it, and clearly at some point in the very near future, the creation of the second phase, which is about allies to the LGBT network, and which we will be seeking allies from members as well to support people in the workplace around tackling that inequality that either exists or doesn't. But again, giving people a safe place to be able to go and know they're supported in the workplace. Very well received by staff. In regards to our quality objectives, in summary, three of the five targets have been met. would argue, you know, probably, you know, the one around road traffic collisions has been partially met, and objective five around recruitment. I think Jackie has gone into a significant amount of detail around the diversity. But what I would say is, you know, in probably September this year, we will be hosting a conference which people in organisational development, so Lynn Hughes, will host on behalf of the Chief Fire Officers Association nationally, to emphasise the value that apprentices and traineeships have had within Merseyside, but how that can extend across the whole UK fire rescue service, and then, you know, utilising the strength of the work to instil that kind of ethos more broadly than Merseyside. And on that point, Shane, I will pause to take any questions.
I just wondered, do you have from the female staff bringing the babies into work because they're still nursing them, or because of the breastfeeding?
We've discussed a quite great deal around that breastfeeding guidance, and certainly dependent on role and responsibilities, you know, that is something we could consider. Now, clearly in an operational setting that's quite difficult.
Yeah.
However, you know, the guidance was generated on the back of female firefighters, not necessarily, you know, staff within headquarters role. We'll work with them to come up with, you know, ways in which we could facilitate that if someone wanted to continue to breastfeed. And we will create and have, and in the process of creating, a place where an individual could go to breastfeed if they so wish. So, you know, within the cardiologist's of fitting in around an operational role, but, you know, absolutely we would explore those opportunities if they could be facilitated. But really discreet, you know, place where they can just go and breastfeed without being or feeling a sort of big deal or an issue for them.
Would look after the baby then once you finish?
Well, it's more around the car, someone. Mother, father, son, daughter, bringing the baby, and then the mother being allowed to breastfeed. It's about the car, the enabling that to take place. So, Wendy, I don't know whether you want to.
Yeah, can I just, often what happens is babies may be off for, say, 12 months for their maternity. Some ladies can't afford to stay off for the full 12 months because obviously there's no doing pay. So, should they want to come back sooner, the baby may not be fully on solids. And therefore, we might require, they may require the facility to express milk.
Yeah.
So, baby probably, you know, feeding during the day, but still not feeding fully at night using the bottle. So, that's kind of the usual reason, and was the reason why we developed it for indeed an individual to come back with that request. So, we did a lot of good practice around that, and they get 12 weeks before they need to be fully operational back on duty. To enable them to do that, and I can feedback that individual was baby was able to move on to solids and the bottle after 7 weeks, and the feedback I got from the individual was just amazing. She said, you know, I feel totally relieved. I can focus now fully on going back operational. I've not got to worry about the fact that, you know, I've got a baby at home that I've still got to, you know, feed in a certain way. So
that's all about expressing.
I would say so, you know. We wouldn't tend to be able to accommodate everybody.
Yeah.
But, you know, sometimes it could be a lunchtime food, and it does depend on what the needs are of the baby in terms of whether they can have cow's milk or whatever. So there is a lot to consider.
Okay.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, it's an excellent report, and I've been tasked in other organisations to be the policy diversity champion, and I always take everything that we do here, and clearly not all of this applies to other organisations, but it's a fantastic document, and I've even shared it, would you believe, with some staff from immigration at Manchester Airport, because theirs is so lacking, in my opinion anyway, into how comprehensive we do this, and I just wanted to say how excellent it was. Just a question really on mental health awareness, and in particular the whole agenda, which quite rightly now is getting a lot of press and publicity, and that's around dementia and dementia awareness. Just wondering really if you could elaborate a little bit more on how we actually engage with people who have dementia, and whether or not there's the opportunity for staff and I would hope members as well to sign up to the Dementia Friends, which can be done in a couple of stages, even on the internet and even via social media.
I'll just have to now place my head on the block here. We have signed up on behalf of the, you know, the fire party to the Dementia Friends. understanding, recognise it and so on and so forth. And as we move forward now around the concept of safe and well, it is the aspiration for what will be done on behalf of the authority that every one of our staff in a front-facing role, so prevention teams and firefighters, will have dementia awareness training. And so we will become fully dementia friendly in the next 12 months.
Okay, any other points or issues on that item? Another good report, yes?
Just to say, Chair, under the district updates, it's mentioned here in Liverpool North, and it's because I think all the act together, and I know Sharon attended one when she was born there, basically it's secondary schools across Liverpool, and I don't know whether it's in any of the authorities, led by Merseyside Police. And what did the young people in each of them schools did? They pick a theme. I'm delighted to see that the theme for Holly Lodge Girls School have picked a theme around Tarson. And one of our officers, Luke Hughes, who I do know from the Prince's Trust, was the mentor. So what these mentors do, man, you could pick any subject, but it's good to see that they've picked Tarson. And they go in, the mentors will go in and work with these young people in the schools, who write a script, work on that script, and then to a massive audience of about, you know, several hundred, it could be at times, and they present that one night, and there's usually six or seven schools across Liverpool that participate in that. So I know the value in what the young people say to get out of this act together. And the fact that, I mean, I think it's something that we should continue to support, although it's police-led. The police have been struggling of late because of the financial costs. And it's not an awful lot of money. I think it's something like £300 for each school to take part. So we need to be encouraging more of that. But the fact that Luke was there, assisting, and it being a girls' school, because you normally find anything to do with the fire, it's the lad that wanted to get involved in it.
Okay, well, thank you for that. Anything else on that item? If not, we come on to the annual environmental performance report, page 119.
Thanks, Chair. And the purpose of this report is request that members consider the annual environmental performance of the Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority owned properties. Paragraph 3 will detail the six local performance indicators that we're focused on: electricity, gas, water, waste, carbon output, and then the proportion of high-risk environmental incidents. And again, just to bring to the forefront of the card, the highlights from an electricity point of view, the difference, and it will be equaled out as we look down to the other issues around gas. It's been a 5.06% increase in our electricity usage over the period. Gas is 5.59% below the previous 12 months. Water, 4.79% below, and waste, 18.58%. The specifics of that, the electricity and what we're seeing as the increase is down to now the full completion of the Joint Command and Control Centre, full utilisation for the period that we're in there, 14-15 period, where it wasn't utilised to its full. And the increase in consumption has been minimised by a number of issues which are detailed on paragraph 6 between A to B, which I don't intend to go into specifics, but it is about continually monitoring the environment to ensure that we are as efficient as we possibly can be. But what I would draw members' attention to is that some 166,000, which is equivalent to about 25% of the annual electricity cost, it hasn't been recovered by tenants in collaboration with sharing space. So again, and that's a theme within the electricity, the gas, the water, and so on, where because we are co-located and sharing premises, we are able to share some of the costs and some of the overheads. Clearly, gas and electricity will be probably consumed more, but the fact that we are able to recoup the costs associated with that and become more effective around that collaborative piece with North West Downing Service and Merseyside Police. The report goes on to talk about the gas and why the reductions have occurred, water, and you'll see in the subsequent appendices where we are now got robust management systems in place where we are able to identify those areas that stand out. So for a period of time, water levels might be at X consumption, and then in a particular month it spikes immediately identify that and then go out and investigate the cause. And that's resulted in certainly a number of leaks being found on fire stations, but also within the car, the underground water systems, which again has made some savings. Waste, we've either seen a significant 18% reduction on last year's figure, which again complements and contributes to that carbon management. Carbon management, whilst you know, we've seen it increase by 3%, this figure is still well below the 100 CO2 per cubic meter, per square meter, per year indicative figure expected for that type of building that we've got. Our efficiency rating of our buildings is D or above, which is better than expected as well. And then environmental impacts, so then significant incidents which would cause us some concern, which could result in pollution or otherwise. We've had no category 1 or 2 environmental incidents reported in the 12 months. And a lot of that goes down to the work that we are doing collaboratively with the Goyans, who have put in place a robust environmental plan for us. And you know, just a couple of the highlights there, you know, vehicles now, we've started to introduce vehicles which meet you know, those 6 emission compliant engines. And also we are about to trial an electric vehicle for tender requirements, so to take kit and equipment to fire stations. And we'll look at the feasibility, the reliability of it over a 12-month period to see whether there's any value in introducing that further to cut down on petrol or diesel costs. And again, Shane, I'm happy to take any questions about that specific report.
Are there any questions on that report? It's to consider, is it considered and agreed? Thank you. Next is item 6. Review of the effectiveness of public consultation, page 133.
Thanks, Chair. Again, personal report is that members scrutinised the performance concerning the arrangement of public consultation, particularly in relation to proposing to close or merge fire stations. Our members will recall that we've delayed this report on a number of occasions just to give us enough information to be able to present back to members, and particularly around some external. Some external independent scrutiny of the kind of procedures that were put in place around our approach to consultation more broadly. So we've had independent internal audits to take a look at the work that we've done in regards to the consultation that we've done within Knowsley, St Helens, the Whittle, and at Allerton in Liverpool, and give us a view and a perspective on that. And it's also extend that to the work that we've done around our consultation process around our integrated management planning procedures, which we do with ORS. And the details of which are contained within the main body of the report, which is there with on page 137. But some of the kind of key aspects to draw from the report is, you know, broadly, you know, and again, it's audit language really, you know, the consultation exercise that take place over the past few years, we've taken adequate steps to engage all interested parties. And there's a recognition there within the report that says, times gone by, our integrated risk management planning consultation has been limited. We have hosted them on fire stations, we've publicised it as much as we were possibly able to, but we have very few numbers of individuals attend. And we've been very much more proactive in how we've tried to engage and consult more broadly. So it's a valuable and meaningful consultation rather than being an effect.